Welcome to the second lecture on our chapter on geometric algorithms. Today we will discuss two geometric problems that are not that canonical in a computational geometry course, but I think nevertheless are really good examples because they illuminate techniques that are very general and can help to solve many problems in algorithms. So the first one is a very simple one, or maybe you can view it as the most simple version of a very interesting family of algorithms that can get also more sophisticated. And the second one is an advanced data structure that's surprisingly space efficient given what you may learn in other courses. Okay, so our first problem is the smallest enclosing ball problem. In a sense, it continues the convex hull problem we considered as a last problem last time, because it kind of a simplification of a point set by a single geometric object that contains all these points. For the convex hull problem, that was still a relatively complex object, namely a convex polygon. Now we want to have a very simple object, namely simply a circle. Since I also want to give you an example of a geometric optimization problem that works for general dimension, I'm doing something more general, namely I immediately do it for d dimensions. But I will give all the examples for two dimensions. Okay, so the smallest enclosing ball problem is the following. We have a point set P equals P1 to Pn of points in the d-dimensional Euclidean space. And we want to find a ball B with minimal radius. So for D equals 2, that's a circle or disk. So it should have minimal radius, but it should contain all the points in P. So below you see two examples. And it actually turns out that if the point set is in general position, then two or three points define this disk. Or in general, up to d plus one points. And that will be an important feature that we are exploiting here. So in particular, if you look at the literature for this problem, so this is used in statistics all over, then the older algorithms and also some that are used in practice use this as a numerical optimization problem. You kind of put a circle around this and kind of shrink it using numerical computations. But this property that a small number of points defines the smallest enclosing ball means that we can also view it as a combinatorial problem. So a brute force algorithm would try out all triples of points and check which one is the smallest one and contains the point set. Of course, that would be hugely inefficient. That would be a n to the fourth algorithm, right? You pick all triples of points, and then you have to check all the points. But we will see that a combinatorial approach can also be much more efficient. We present a simple algorithm which actually has expected linear time. And it's combinatorial, so in contrast to some numerical algorithm, it doesn't just converge to the optimum. It clearly finds the optimum solution. At least if the numerical precision of some simple predicates is high enough. So that's an algorithm due to Emo Welzel from 1991. So I think he was in Berlin at that time. Now he is at ETH. So it's also a European result in a sense. Okay, so here's a pseudocode. It's very simple. It has a long name because we say, okay, it's the smallest enclosing ball problem. And we kind of generalize the problem. We don't pass not only pass not only the set of points that should be contained, but additionally a set Q of points where we already know that they are part of the definition of the optimal solution. So initially Q is empty. Okay, and then there's a very simple base case. If there are no points to be contained, then the solution is certainly the smallest enclosing ball around Q. Since this is at most d+1 points, it's uniquely defined by these points, actually. And similarly, if Q has already d+1 points, then according to our observation, or it's a basic known geometrical thing that a ball is defined by d+1 points, then we simply return this result. Then we basically already have the result. Okay, so that's a simple base case. It's a linear recursion. No, it's actually a two-way recursion we are doing here. But it turns out that one of the recursive calls is called only rarely. Okay, so it's a randomized algorithm. We are picking a random point in P that we remove from P and see what happens, right? So we recursively solve a problem that's smaller by one. And now there's a simple case distinction. Either X is within the ball computed for the smaller input, then B is also a solution of the overall problem, and we are done. We can return B. Otherwise, I claim that X must be part of the solution. We can move it into Q and do our call again without X here, but moving X into Q. So this picture shows these two cases. So if X is within this ball, then we are done. Or if the ball is this one defined by the blue points here, but X is actually outside, then I claim the overall solution is contains X on the ball. And by the way, these other points, we have to drop at least some of them, right? I mean, here it looks like actually, I don't know, this, and this point will be the correct solution. So in order to prove correctness of this, we mainly have to show that we can actually conclude that X is part of the solution. And that's actually quite simple to show. This is just repeating this pseudocode. So we want to show that X is not in B in this pseudocode, then X is on the boundary of the smallest enclosing ball of P. And the proof is very simple by contradiction. So we say, okay, what happens if this is not true? So if X is not on the boundary of the smallest enclosing ball of P, then yeah, then I mean, P still contains X, right? So the smallest enclosing ball of P must contain X. So X has to be in the interior of it. But that also means that if I remove it, X from P, I get the same ball. And that means X is inside B. But that's the negation of this. So we proved by contradiction, not this, then not this. So the original thing was true. One caveat, in order for this conclusion to work, we also have to show that smallest enclosing balls are unique. Okay, so let's look at that. So suppose we have two smallest enclosing balls, B1 and B2, for our points at P, and they are not the same. So what does that mean? Since they are both enclosing balls, the point set must be subset of B1 and subset of B2. But that's equivalent to saying that the input set is a subset of the intersection of these two balls. So see a picture here for the two-dimensional case, right? There's a blue circle and the green circle. Then this fat red thing is the intersection of the blue and the green circle. That must also contain all the points of B. But as you see, the smallest enclosing ball of this thing is actually this small red circle, and it has a smaller radius than either B1 or B2, which contradicts the assumption that B1 and B2 are smallest enclosing balls. So we have shown what we wanted. Now let's look at the running time. We count the expected number of tests for X to be contained in a ball and call it T of P, comma Q, where P is the number of elements in capital P in the call, and Q is the number of elements in capital Q. And so what do we know? We have our base case that TP D plus 1 is 0. We don't have to make any more comparisons. And similar, T1 comma P is 0. So if you have only one point, or if you already have D plus 1 points in the boundary. So we also know, we can also give a recurrence for the non-base cases. TPQ is less than or equal. So if I don't have a base case, I do have to make one comparison here, right? I don't have the base case, and this happens, and then within the body of this outermost recursive call, I make one comparison. This has size of P reduced by 1 and size of Q remains the same. So then I may have to do a second one, but in expectation, the number of calls is a probability that X is not in B times the cost for the recursive call with P and Q plus 1. So actually, here we could also put P minus 1, but I guess the computation is simpler this way. And we can calculate this probability, or at least estimate it, because we need D plus 1 minus Q more points on the boundary, right? And if I pick a random point, the probability to pick one of them is simply D plus 1 minus Q divided by the total number of points P. I have this fairly ugly recurrence. But we will see that it's relatively easy to solve. It's a little bit of writing work, but it's not so difficult to solve. Let's do it for D equals 2. So first, let's start with the base cases, write them down again. Here, just for reference, I gave the general recurrence once more. And we will use this multiple times now. Now let's start with the case TP, 2, which is for D equals 2, the largest value that we don't know yet, because TP, 3, we know it's 0. Okay? So TP, 2, we substitute this here is 1 plus TP minus 1, 2 plus, here it's 2 plus 1 minus 0 2 plus 1 minus 2 is 1, right? Divided by P, this is 1 over P TP, comma 3, substituting q plus 1 is this, right? But we know that this is 0. So it's less than or equal 1 plus tp minus 1 comma 2. So that's now very simple, right? Tp comma 2 is less than or equal tp minus 1 comma 2. And if I substitute that again and again, I add 1 here and subtract 1 here. And that ends when p is at 1. When the first parameter is at 1. So overall, actually, that means it's simply tp comma 2 is less than or equal p. Because I do this p times the substitution. Okay? I mean, I could more formally prove that now using induction, but I think it's pretty clear, right? So now let's go down to the next case. Tp comma 1. I once again substitute the definition here. It's 1 plus tp minus 1 comma 1 plus 2 plus 1 minus 1 is 2. So 2 over p. 2 over p times tp comma 2. But I know tp comma 2. It's simply p. So it's less than or equal 1 plus tp minus 1 comma 1 plus 2 over p times p. The p cancels out. We have a plus 2 here. Adding it to the 1 here gets us a 3. So tp comma 1 is 3 plus tp minus 1 comma 1. And I get the same simple linear recurrence as I got here. We do this p times, each time we add 3, so we get a bound of 3p. And now I can repeat it for tp equals 0. I once more do the substitution here. Here we have d plus 1 minus 0 is 3 divided by p, so 3 over p times tp comma 1. Tp comma 1 is 3p, so it's 3 times 3p over p, it's 9p, plus 1, it's 10p. So it's tp comma 0 is 10 plus tp minus 1 comma 0. So once more, such a simple linear recurrence, and I overall get 10p. So similarly, we can do this kind of game for a general dimension. And what we get is for one dimension, 3n, for two, we derive 10n, for three, it's 41n, for four, it's 206n. So actually, this is a nice example for the problem we have with high dimensions, right? Which is also called the curse of dimensionality. So one can easily show that tp comma 0 is larger than or equal d factorial times n. And actually you see that it grows even faster. So this algorithm is not so practical for high dimensions. But as I already mentioned, there are better, slightly more complicated algorithms that are still based on the same principle of randomized construction. Which is what I give you now in this survey here. For larger constants, there are more efficient algorithms. The dependence of D is much better. Similarly, we can do linear programming for constant number of dimensions in linear time. So it's something like n times something that depends on d, and that dependence might be large. But still, there are some applications where we have constant dimension, and then that's much faster than using a general purpose linear programming solver. Or we can keep the, I mean, this is also a geometric problem, right? It's an optimization problem involving half planes. But we can also stick with curved objects, and then it's relatively easy to generalize these algorithms to smallest enclosing ellipsoids, smallest enclosing annulus, and so on. And there are actually lots of applications where this is used. An interesting thing is also that under certain circumstances, an important machine learning technique, the so-called support vector machines, also can be solved with fast algorithms in this framework. Because then actually one can show that support vector machines are an instance of a generalized description of such problems, which Sharia and Welzel term coined LP-type problems. So all of these problems are actually just an instantiation of this family of LP-type problems, which are characterized by the following features. First, a constant number of objects defines the optimum. And if you insert an object, then either the solution remains the same or the new object is part of the solution. And with these simple assumptions, they show that you can always design a randomized linear time algorithm, which is, I think, an amazing thing and one of the most interesting achievements of geometric algorithms, if you want, but actually in the definition of this, the geometric doesn't show up, so I'm not sure whether that's not even a more general approach to optimization problems. Okay, the second problem is a static data structure for two-dimensional range queries. Now, this is something that really works only for two dimensions, but of course, that's already an important problem. Okay, we have once more a set of endpoints in the plane. And we have queries that are defined by rectangles, so formally the cross product of two closed intervals. And there are two types of range queries. Either we want to intersect the point set with the rectangle, meaning we want to find all the points that are in the rectangle. Or we want to count these points, which is called a range counting query. The other is a range reporting query. We are allowed to pre-process P in order to accelerate queries. More generally, we might also look for a dynamic data structure, but today I only want to explain to you a static data structure that's particularly simple and space efficient. Okay. What's the pre-processing time? We want something like order n log n. We want to have linear space. We would like to have logarithmic query time, at least for counting. For reporting, it would be nice to have k plus log n when there are k points in the rectangle. We won't quite achieve that. We will have show something with k times log n, or at least outline that. And as you can imagine, there are lots of different papers on whether you can achieve that, some of them very complicated additional assumptions, blah, blah, blah. But for this introductory course, I think I can show you already something quite advanced that not everybody is aware of. So let's first do the one-dimensional problem. Here, actually, we can do simply a search tree. So a set of points in one dimension can be represented by a sorted sequence of the coordinates of these points. And then a range query asks for the set of points within a given range, which is known as a range query in a sorted sequence. In particular, if you implement this with a search tree, we can do that in time order log n plus k by locating the smallest elements larger than or equal to the left
border of the range, and then scanning the set of points. So in this case, I used a search tree that also stores a doubly linked list of the leaves. That's actually how we introduce search trees in algorithms one in my book. And then you basically locate the first element that should be reported in the query, if there's any such element, and then you simply scan through this list until you drop outside. You could, of course, also implement counting like this, but that would be expensive if there are many elements in the range. But what you can do, you can augment the search tree with the size of the subtrees. So that in any of the interior nodes here, you can count the number of nodes below. And then it's very easy to implement a rank operation that tells you for a given key how many elements are less than or equal to that key. That's also in my book and in at least my version of the algorithms one lecture. And then you compute the rank of the right border, subtract the rank of the left border, and you have answered your counting query in logarithmic time. The nice thing of the search tree implementation is that it's dynamic. You can also insert points. The solution I will give you for two dimensions is static. But we have a trade-off here. So there are also dynamic two-dimensional data structures for range searching, but they need, I think, space n log n. And I'm not quite sure right now about the query time, whether that is not also worse, maybe log square n. But I think there are logarithmic time solutions, but they need more space. What I will give you is a relatively simple solution. I mean, the dynamic one is also a bit messy because you have a search tree, and in each leaf you store another search tree, so it's kind of complicated. What I described to you here is actually fairly simple and elegant, although it uses a few quite nasty tricks. So the first trick we do is we reduce this continuous problem with real numbers or floating point numbers or whatever, or integers that are very large if the inputs are integer, to a discrete problem with integers in the range 1 to n. I will make the simplifying assumption here that all the coordinates are pairwise distinct. So each x coordinate only shows up once, each y coordinate shows up only once. This assumption can be lifted, however, using some additional complications, which in this case I don't want to molest you with. So I thought in this chapter I give you the feeling of what it takes to lift assumptions in the line segment intersection problem, but I don't want to do it every time because that gets a bit tiresome and is maybe more adequate for a specialized lecture on computational geometry. Right? Okay. And then our strategy will be to replace the continuous coordinates by their rank in the sorted sequence of coordinates, and that we can do both for x and y coordinate. Let me first give you an example. So suppose we have the points at 2.5, 1000, 1.4, 500, and 4.2, 700. So I intentionally choose this point set with a very different scale in each dimension. But we can simply say, okay, I mean, this is the smallest x coordinate, this is the second smallest one, this is the third smallest one. So I replace this by 1, 2, 3. And similarly, the y coordinates, 1, 2, 3. And then I get this discrete point set. And the nice thing is here, we don't lose information here because we can also translate query rectangles into a discrete thing. So this query rectangle would translate into this one. And you see that it contains the same point set. So let's look at pseudocode for this. So if x1 through xn is a sequence of the x coordinate and y1 through yn is a sequence of y coordinate, I can simply sort it and store them in the sequences px and py. And now I replace my point set p by a discrete point set, in this case of the same name, where for each input point x, y in p, I replace x by the position of x in px and using binary search, and y I replace by the position of y in py. Okay. By the way, that might be an interesting exercise. The running time of sorting is n log n, but the constants are good because you can do it in a fairly cache efficient way. We saw that in part in the chapter on external memory algorithms, right? But binary search is much less cache efficient. Can you give an algorithm that is basically as cache efficient as sorting just the coordinates? Or maybe with a small constant factor, but avoids this cache miss prone binary search. It's not that difficult. Okay. That's all the pre-process. No, that's not all the pre-processing. But I explained to you how the query rectangles can also be translated into discrete ones. So if you have a query rectangle x, x prime, y, y prime, then you can search all these things by binary search. The x and x prime you search in px, the y and y prime you search in py. Binary search, so that takes logarithmic time. And now you do a range query on the on this discrete rectangle, getting a result. In this case, it's a range reporting problem. And now you scan through your result points, which are discrete points, right? And you can translate them back by just using x and y as indices in px and py, respectively. So construction time is order n log n. Space is order n machine words for storing these coordinates. Query time is order log n plus the time for the integer range query. So the data structure we are going to use for the integer range query is called a wavelet tree. And that thing also actually has a quite interesting history. It was rediscovered several times. So I'm citing actually three papers here. I could also cite a paper by myself and Beat Queller, I think, and Peter Wittmeier from 2009. Where I also rediscovered it, but for a very specific use where I didn't notice that this is actually this thing, where we used it to do a data structure for range median queries. So you have a set of an array of elements, and you want to specify ranges, and for each for such a query range, you want to have the median element within this range, which is something you need in certain data analysis problems. And we found a quite elegant algorithm for doing that with n log n preprocessing time, logarithmic query time. And it actually turned out it was this wavelet tree used in a different way. So the wavelet tree is not just for range queries. It's a quite versatile representation of integer point sets. And actually, Roberto Grossi here, and also Jeff Witter to some extent, they are actually not computational geometers, but they are stringologists. So they do string algorithms. And it turns out that in the section on string algorithms, some of the basic problems discussed there can also be solved using wavelet trees. Okay, so where does a wavelet tree? So I said it represents our discrete point set, and observe that it's very easy to represent this point set that has both x and y coordinates exactly the set 1 through n. Because a point set we can sort in arbitrary order, right? And what we do now is we sort it in the order so that it reads x1, 1, x2, 2, and so on. So we sort it top down along the y coordinate. And then we don't really have to store this 1 through n in the y coordinate. So we can completely represent this point set simply by the sequence of x coordinates. Okay? That's the first normalization of the point set we do. And now we organize it into the following tree structure. So we have a base case if we have a sequence of points that has less than n0 elements, then we store it directly. That the base case is usually and it's a constant number of points. Then, otherwise, if it's not the base case, we store a bit vector b, which has a 1-bit at the ith position if and only if xi is larger than n over 2. So the nice thing here is this bit vector takes only n bits, whereas the input here is n log n bits, right? So we can afford to store much more data. Actually, we will store bit vectors and on every level of this tree. And that's the main advantage compared to more classical range search tree data structures, that using this highly compressed data, we get a better overall space efficiency. And it's also quite simple. Okay, we store this bit vector at this interior node of the wavelet tree, and we recursively build a left and a right wavelet tree, where the left wavelet tree contains those xi that are less than or equal n over 2, and the other one contains those xi that are less than or equal, that are larger than n over 2. And since they are all larger than n over 2, we simply subtract n over 2. And that way, we maintain the invariant that the x coordinates are just a permutation of 1 through the size of the sequence. Okay? Yeah, and I do this recursively. Yes, running time of this is linear for scanning your sequence x1 through xn and splitting it into two subsequences and setting a bit for each of these values. So here's an example of a wavelet tree for this point set. We are splitting along the x coordinate in the middle, right? We have 4 points to the left in this case, 4 points to the right. And these bits indicate the points that lie in the right half. And the other bits are 0, right? Now we are basically copying this point set over. Implicitly, since we are not even storing the y coordinates, we are compressing them
the y coordinates also to the range 1 through n over 2. And the smaller ones have range 1 through n over 2 anyway. And similarly for the right half, we're copying it over and shifting it to the left so that once more we maintain the invariance that the input in each subtree is 1 through some value on with respect to both coordinates. So let's look at the right branch of this tree. So now we have this point in this compressed form. We cut it again in right and left half. Now this and this point are on the right half, so we store this bit vector. And notice we have 8 bits stored here, and we have 2 × 4 equals 8 bits stored here. And we could go on one more level if you want, but actually for the here I choose n0 equals 2 for the base case. So now we will first study how to use the wavelet tree to do a range counting query. Recall that we already did the reduction of range, a general range query to an integer range query. So actually the pseudocode I showed you here was for the range reporting query, where we went through all these things. Yeah, maybe it's a simple question you can think about as an exercise. How do you adapt this if you want a range counting query? Yes, so how do you translate a general range counting query into this discrete range counting query? Okay, so either way, your solution will translate the general range counting query into an integer range counting query. The x and x prime, y and y prime are integers between 1 and n. And this can be translated into 4 even simpler counting queries, namely so-called dominance counting queries. A dominance counting query given a position, say x, y, counts the number of points that are in this quadrant of the coordinate system. So all the points whose x coordinate is larger than or equal to x and whose y coordinate is larger than or equal to y. So suppose a solid black thing is a rectangle where we all actually want to count. Now we first count the number of inputs dominating x, y, that's all the points in this rectangle going all the way through n. And of course we counted too much now. We want just this, not the entire thing here. Okay, now we subtract this rectangle, which can be, the number of points there can be counted by calling the range counting queries with coordinates x and y prime. We also subtract this rectangle, which is done by dominance counting for x prime comma y. Now I did a mistake. I subtracted the number of the points in this rectangle twice. So I add them back using yet another dominance counting query using x prime and y prime as the parameter. So what I have done now, I have shown you 2 relatively straightforward reductions. First, a reduction from a general range query to an integer range query, and then a reduction from an integer range counting query to an integer dominance counting query, or to actually 4 of them. But now I actually have to do the actual thing, right? I have to implement the integer dominance counting query, which basically is a specialized range counting query x, n product y, n, and you look for the number of points in this rectangle. So, and this function actually you should think of as
a method that's called at an interior node or at a node of the wavelet tree. Okay, so and the n has a local meaning of how many points are represented by this subtree we are currently looking at. And if n is less than or equal n zero, then we directly store the point set, right? So we simply scan through the point set, check whether this point is in the rectangle xn, yn, and count the number of hits we found, the brute force algorithm. Otherwise, we first compute the rank of y in the bit vector. Let's consider what that means. So suppose, let's look at this example. We have this point set, and the blue lines give our range. And the green line is the splitting thing, n over 2 on the x-axis. Yr, that we compute here, is actually, in this case, 2. It's the number of points that are in the right half with respect to the x-axis, and below our limit y. So that means the number of points that are to the right of this green line and have a value larger than or equal to y is n over 2 minus yr. That's why I'm adding n over 2 here in the return statement and subtracting yr. But of course, I haven't solved the problem completely now, because I have only counted the number of points in the right half that are, should be returned for this dominance counting query. I also have to do it in the left half. So let's look at this example where the x-coordinate is actually in the left half. Then I simply add the number of points I find in the left half using the same x-coordinate, but subtracting yr for the y-coordinate for my query, because recall that the y-coordinates in this wavelet tree are represented implicitly. In each subtree, I just have one numbers 1 through number of points considered here. So in other words, yr is not only needed for computing the result for this case that x is in the left half, but it also helps us to translate the coordinate system in this interior node to the coordinate system used in the subtrees. So for the case that the x boundary for the query is in the left half, in the right half, the problem is actually a little bit simpler, because I only have to look in the right part of my wavelet tree, and now I have to do the translation for both coordinates. I have to subtract n over 2 for my bound, because that's what I also did during pre-processing, and once more I have to subtract yr for the now I have to substitute yr for y in the right part, because yr was the number of elements less than or equal to the bound in the right half. I already know that, so the yr is the right bound value in the right half of the left tree, of the wavelet tree to be used. So let's have a look at an example. So suppose we want to solve this dominance counting query. We count, so we have the y coordinate 3, right? And we count, we compute the rank of the bit vector at position 3, so the number of 1s below this position, this is 1. That's our yr.
you have four elements to the right of the splitter here. I mean, 8 points overall and four to the right. So to the right, above y, we have 4 minus 1 points. And that's this part of the output. And then we are making a recursive call for the left subtree. And here, the x coordinate in this recursive call remains the same, it's 2. The y coordinate is reduced by yr because now this number of elements below the line to the right isn't part of this left subset, right? So recursive call is on 2, 2. So it's now split here. There are no elements below the query line on the right half, so yr is 0. So the result is number of elements on the right minus 0 is 2. So overall, our counting query tells us the result is 5 so far. There's another recursive call, but that doesn't yield any additional results. So what about the running time? We have only one recursive call on each level. The recursion def is order log n. And assuming we can compute this rank operation in constant time, we get overall execution time order log n. And we will see below that this is indeed possible. So implementing a range reporting query with wavelet trees is a bit more difficult. I will only give you a partial solution, namely I will tell you how to compute a dominance reporting query. So one can also call that a two-sided query because there's a constraint from the left and from the bottom, but not to the right and to the top. We can implement a reporting query for rectangles based on this, but there's a problem. Perhaps think about as an exercise why this is not really helpful in an efficient general rectangular range reporting query. Okay, so the reporting query is similar to the counting query, but slightly more complicated. So we have the same base case thing, except that we return the intersection with the query rectangle rather than only counting it. We have a result variable r that we initialize at the empty set. Then, as before, we compute the number of elements below the query line on the right half. And as before, we make a case distinction whether the x coordinate of the query is on the left or on the right side. The easier case is on the right side, then basically we do a recursive dominance reporting there with the same parameters as before in the counting query. If the x coordinate of the query is in the left half, then both halves are interesting. And on the left half, we do a dominance reporting, and on the right half, let's look at this example, right? We have this case here. So in the left half, we do this, do a reporting recursively in the left subtree. On the right subtree, actually we need everything. We could do a dominance reporting query there, but we can also do a one-sided reporting query, which simply looks for all the elements above a certain y-coordinate. And that's what we are doing here. The additional tests here are not that important. They just avoid cases where I do recursive calls that don't return anything and that might have out of bound problems. So the one-sided reporting is also recursive with a base case. We again compute the rank of y we again have a result set and we have to recurse on both halves. And maybe here it's easier to see than in the pseudocode before. I don't want to recur on subtrees that are empty, because then I'm, for example, in this case, I'm traversing the entire subtree without producing results. If I make sure that I only recurse on subtrees where there's actually a result, I can charge the cost for traversing this to the elements that I'm discovering. So that's a crucial point here. Let's look at the analysis. So we are looking at a recurrence that has two parameters, the number of elements and the number of the size of the result. And for the base case, if I don't produce anything, it's constant time. In the general case, if nothing is output, then I do one recursive call plus constant time. Yeah, so why do I do only one recursive call? Well, in this case, I do only a single recursive call, or respectively do the dominance reporting thing, the one-sided thing, which has only one recursion in case this is zero. And that's always the thing here. If both recursive calls are made, then both return at least one element. If no results are produced, there is at most one recursive call. And that's what basically this recurrence here says. So for no results, I get time order log n. The general case, where k larger than or zero is, here's the time for two recursive calls. And yeah, I don't know how much I report in the pieces, so let this be k prime, less than or equal k. Then here we get k minus k prime. And outside the recursive calls, we have constant time. And now, using an inductive proof, I can show that this is some constant times the result size log n, and then it's ck prime log n plus ck minus k prime log n plus some constant, and this is c plus 1 plus k log n, which is order k log n. So that's not quite what we wanted. Better would be running time k plus log n, but that I cannot achieve with this very space efficient representation, because in order to reconstruct my elements, I have to traverse the tree. I can change that by storing complete lists of elements stored in a subtree on all levels, and then I have a log factor more space. So maybe it's interesting if we have some time to discuss how this could be implemented. So let's very shortly have a look at how a general reporting query could look like. So actually we can think about four-sided, three-sided, two-sided, and one-sided queries here. Let's look at this. So suppose we have a rectangular query. If this rectangle is completely on one side of the division line, then I simply recurse on towards the right side. If it's cut by the division line, I actually have in each of the subtrees, three-sided queries, which are open or going to the end of the set on one side. There are actually two variants of this, because namely a three-sided query that's open to the right and a three-sided query that's open to the left. You have to implement both of them. Now let's look at the three-sided query that's open to the left, for example, here. If it's on the same side, then it's just a plain recursion. Now on the right here, I have a three-sided query open to the left. Let's say this one is cut by the x half n over 2 separator. Then what we see is here on the right side, I get once more a three-sided query that's open to the left. And actually on the left half, I get a two-sided query that is basically a y-range query. This can be implemented in a similar way than the one-sided y-range query. And so on. And if one is careful, one always makes recursive calls only for subtrees that actually contain some data. And then everything works out fine. And as I said, you should think about why you can't simply build it out of dominance reporting queries. So what I still owe you is how to implement the rank operation on bit vectors efficiently. So what we do here is use yet another data structure, namely a bit vector data structure that supports these operations. And we need some pre-processing, but it's linear time and a linear number of bits space. Actually, there are variants that take a lower order term in additional space. And actually, we can do it in time order n over log n using bit parallelism. But that's not so important now. So we give a very simple solution that has a constant space overhead. But still order n bits. So we have a bit vector with n bits, and we cut it into pieces of size theta log n. And now we pre-compute the rank of the last element of each block. So for example, the last element of the first block has rank 4, and we actually store it in the next block, and the 0 is the starting point here. There's another 4 bits here, so here we have an 8. There are only 3 bits here, so it's 8 plus 3, that's 11. And now we can use these pre-computed values to already approximate our rank. Namely, we just look up the in this array b rank j div b for rank j. So for example, at this position here. And then we know, okay, the full blocks before this block had 8 ones. So I just have to count the number of ones up to this position within the block, which is 2, gives us a rank of 10. So by constant time, I can compute this rank very easily using the population count machine instruction, which counts the number of one bits in a register, or actually using table lookup. And maybe as an exercise, think about how to compute the rank using the population count operation. Actually, bit vectors are a quite successful and non-trivial part of algorithm engineering and of compressed data structures. So there's quite something more to know about it, and I will just at least summarize this. So in many other applications of bit vectors, we need not only the rank operation, but also the select operation, which is the position of the ith one bit in the vector. This can also be done in constant time using similar techniques. And we can achieve asymptotic information theoretically optimal space up to a lower order term, little order or of n. And these bit vectors are the basis for many other compressed data structures. So, for example, we can use them as a tool to represent a tree, an arbitrary tree with space 2n plus little o of n bits, and still allow navigation in this tree. So, going to the left, to the right, to count number of subtrees, of leaves in a subtree, etc. So that brings us to the end of the section and geometric algorithm. And note that this bit vector thing we needed for our range query data structure, but actually it's something that's much lower level than geometry and is actually used in several other things. In particular, in string algorithms, we often want compressed data structures that use these bit vectors and so on. Thank you very much.